is going to be helping us think about risk assessment, because I think you'll probably have got the impression today that everything we do is basically about risk assessments, and there isn't much that's in our world that is black and white. And so how do we manage these bits in between and make a risk assessment in order to understand what's the most appropriate use of our resource, and how does that fit in with our governance structures? So thank you, Elise.
Right. Can you hear me in the cheap seats?
Yes, yes.
Good, because I'm going to be talking about governance and I don't want anybody falling asleep. Right, so the objectives are to go through the key governance documents so that you all know what they are and where to find them, and they've been discussed already this morning, but I'll give you a little bit more detail. We'll talk about risk assessment of new builds. I think I'm going to be covering quite a lot of old ground here, but hopefully we might make things a little bit better in the future. And then I'll give you a little bit of a summary of what we've covered, hopefully. So legislation and guidance. Everybody's aware of health and safety at work acts, etc., etc., etc. That's core to everybody's business. It's also very, very key to any new build that's going on as well. There's a plethora of all of this going on. And if you don't get it right, there's all sorts of penalties that can be put into place as well. But I'm not going to go over that in great depth. Drinking water quality. Again, there's a lot of legislation out there about drinking water quality, and there's a few discussions at the moment, especially now that we're Brexited, as to what we're going to be testing for in the future as well. It may be that Legionella and Pseudomonas will be tested for, but who knows? Who knows? ACOP L8. Now we're getting into specifics, and HSG 274, and these are very, very specific to Legionella. And again, this has been legislation that's been in place for quite a number of years, and I have to say, for the amount of cases that we have per annum is very well legislated for. So, you know, potentially 400 or 500 people get infected that we know of, probably more like 4,000 or 5,000. But if you compare it to what we've just seen with COVID, it's a wee beast here, but it is very well legislated for. If you look at it, basically, it's trying to tell you to do risk assessments. Now, those have generally been done later on in a building, and we're not really seeing those risk assessments being done at the design phase and at the build stages and throughout those build stages. And that's a gap, and it's a huge gap, and that's something that we need to discuss and talk to architects and building managers about, and the building teams. What we want to do is prevent and control exposure and provide training, and I'm sure Lena's going to talk to us all about that. But the other thing which is key to this and is written into this legislation and guidance is to have water safety groups and water safety plans. Now that's for all of healthcare, and it's very specific within this document, it's for healthcare. Now, there is guidance available, a new British standard came out last year, but it's not just for healthcare, it should be for any building, in all honesty, but at least we've got some documentation there that we can beat the designers over the head with. If we look at healthcare legislation, we've got the Health and Social Care Act, again, which all of you should be working to, and you've got the Healthcare Associated Infection Code of Practice, which again is very clear. We've got the CQC regulations, so there's audits of buildings, but how much do the CQC know about water and ventilation? Probably not so much. There's one or two I've met which are getting better, but really it's a bit of a tick box exercise, unfortunately. The code of practice is actually very, very helpful. There's a lot of information in there. And it's not just hospitals. We're talking about dental care practices. We're talking about GP surgeries. We're talking about nursing and care homes here as well. So I think we get fixated quite a lot on all these new builds which have gone wrong, but there's a lot of smaller new builds out there which are also not particularly fit for practice, and I'll show you some photos of those later. So the CQC audit against their various criteria, but it does actually include risk assessment in there. But again, people are thinking about risk assessment of the patient and of their care, and you know, are they malnourished, etc. They're not thinking about risk assessment of the equipment and the environment, and I think that's a little bit of a mindset that we do need to perhaps educate the CQC a little bit more. And again, I don't think people really know this, but if you look closer into the guidance, it does say you should have a water safety group and a water safety plan. And this is for every CQC registered property. And there's a lot of those. And I don't think I've seen any water safety groups or water safety plans for, well, certainly, I know my local dentist has one because I wrote it for them. But that's the only one I've seen. So we're way off at the moment. And I think it's that communication, these water safety groups and having the plans in place will hopefully educate people enough to be able to talk to one another when they are putting these new plans in place. We talked about, Christine talked about the health technical memoranda earlier this morning. There's a whole host of technical memoranda. I've just put a few up there which are relevant to today. There's 00, which is kind of the overarching standard, and that talks about authorising engineers and authorised persons, etc. And then you've got the HTMO 401, which is very, very useful, I must admit. It's got some good stuff in there. But then you've got 0704, which actually contradicts 0401 a little bit now, because they were written at different times and things have changed. And 0105, I think the decontamination in dental practices needs a bit of a revisit. It's, you know, needs updating and moving on. So yes, they are out there, but these are guidance. They're movable feasts, and things change and new technologies appear that we need to be aware of. If we look at HTMO 401, it's similar in a way to the Legionella, in that you need to conduct risk assessments, you need to prevent exposure, and also you need to have these water safety groups and water safety plans in place. Now, I do see those happening, certainly in many of the big trusts. Some are more functional than others. And it's certainly a learning curve. And where they do start to work, they are really very, very powerful. But a lot of them are still a little bit clunky, and I see them working very well, and they're very, very reactive, but not always very proactive. And the conversation from the water safety group upwards is sometimes lacking, and getting things onto risk registers and getting them really noticed by the board, yeah, a bit of a gap there. But anywho, health building notes, again, those were discussed by Christine, and I'm just going to list a couple here which hopefully you should be aware of. And that's 09, which is the infection control in the built environment. That's got a lot of useful information in there about how to structure things and how, where things should be placed, how things should be designed, and are certainly taken a little bit more notice of by the architects. And certainly 0010 has got, it tells you what type of basin to put where. What type of toilet to put where. And again, it's a little bit dated, needs a little bit of updating with newer designs. There's a lot more new equipment coming out, certainly in the sanitary ware side of things. There's also masses of industry-specific guidance. And this is one, I think Christy mentioned an organisation called BISRIA, who are sort of building services, and they do a lot of testing and stuff. Now, they've got a really interesting job book, and they've got a whole host of tools on the site for the construction industry. But if you look at it, you know, there's this 8-stage planning process. Well, you know, who knew? I only found this out probably about 2 weeks ago because I listened to somebody else talk about it. But it doesn't tell you how water management fits in. It doesn't really define water safety. It doesn't really talk about the patients. And I think this is something that we're beginning to miss here, is that it's all about the building. It's not about the patient. And it's not about who's going to interact with those spaces either. It's trying to get a building which looks perfect, is fit for purpose from the architect side, but it doesn't end up that way, again, from what Christine was saying earlier. It's far from it. Who's training the design teams? Who's training the architects? Yes, they're aware of certain legislation. Yes, they're aware of certain guidance, but nobody's saying, well, this, if you do this here, if you change that tap there and put it to there, we could prevent a whole load of infection. And I don't think there's that engagement at all, unfortunately. And is there a design risk assessment? Well, very rarely, and certainly not for water, and probably not for the air ventilation either. And who oversees the delivery of it all? There used to be things, people called clerk of works, who would go in and check things had been done properly. And they seem to have been removed because they're a cost. But I have seen those reappearing on certain build sites now. But you need somebody. It's like if you go to the council, you have an extension put on your house, you will have that signed off by somebody who knows. And that's not really getting done properly. There's not a proper handover. And again, all the things to reiterate what Christine said earlier. So if we have a look at risk assessing now, there's some very, very helpful standards, and these are quite recent now. There's the Legionella risk assessment standard, which came out, I think that was 2019, and that's been written, I think, quite well. It's had a lot of input from people who do things as opposed to people that think things. So I think hopefully it's a little bit of more of a practical guide. And what's just about to hit the streets is the next one in the series, which is all to do with Pseudomonas aeruginosa and other waterborne pathogens. And I'm on that working party. It's been interesting. It took about 3 meetings to actually decide the title of that, didn't it, Elaine?
It was a bit of a saga.
So we've gone with Pseudomonas aeruginosa because most people have heard of that. But believe me, it's not all about Pseudomonas aeruginosa. It's about a whole host of other beasties as well. So that's literally in the throes of being written up and edited and will be available, I don't know, maybe even before Christmas if we're very lucky. So
it's been out for consultation and
yeah.
I think the plan is to publish the paper version in January.
Okay. Oh, I was going to say, can't put it on your Christmas present list, so sadly. But and that's built on the same sort of, I think really, if you get a decent Legionella risk assessment in place of your building, that gives you the engineering, the mechanical side, and then you will basically use the second standard to build on that to look at these other organisms and risk assess certain equipment areas, etc. But what it does say in this standard is you have to have a team. You can't just say, right, I'm going to employ Joe Bloggs from such and such a service provider to do my Legionella risk assessment. You're going to have people from infection control, because we're going to need to know things like the incidence of infections. We're going to need people from estates people to sort of show us around. We're going to need nursing staff, and Darren's explained about the incubators. Those are on the hit list, and those are even more on the hit list than I've actually looked inside one. So it's everything that water touches, and it's not going to be an easy task, I don't think. If we have a look at the different types of pathogens out there, I mean, this is a very, very short list, and I have put Klebsiella up there especially for you, Elaine. But we are looking at a whole host of bugs, and there's all sorts of, you know, new kids on the block that we don't even know, and that have been renamed, certainly since I did my training. So I've put the Glasgow one up there, but you've heard all about that this morning. But Papworth, this is, again, new build here, and they've got something called Mycobacterium abscessus there. And it's a very difficult bug to try and treat, and it's a very difficult bug to try and eradicate as well. So these are happening, and I think we are better able to detect them now. We've got much, much better testing equipment with much better knowledge. We've got more libraries of bugs that we can compare against. So it's not that anything's new, we just know what to call it now. Risk assessment process. So again, Martin very clearly demonstrated the hierarchy of control, and I've put as low as reasonably practical in for Dr. Hill. So what we're trying to do is reduce the risk to as low as possible. We know we can't always get rid of it, but if we can just minimise that risk. And the other acronym here is contamination, amplification, transmission, exposure, susceptibility. And that's really what these risk assessment documents are asking us to look at. So if I have a look at those in a little bit more detail, and again, this is just very quick. For contamination, we're not just looking for a blob of gunk on a piece of equipment. We want to know what's there. So if you've got a building on new on handover, you don't want any bacteria in the water. You don't want any of those in your water supply. And unfortunately, this is generally what you're given. On handover, you test for it, that's what will be there. So ideally, your building, it won't be sterile, but it just won't have these pathogens. Or if they are there, they're in areas which you haven't got susceptible patients, perhaps. But it's very, very important that this is monitored really upfront, and that when they start to fill the building with water, that that water is constantly turned over and we're not getting areas of stagnation. Amplification. So if we do get them in our building, well, that's fine. We just don't want them to grow anymore. So how can we prevent that? Cracking design here. So let's see if I can press the right button. It's one big one in the middle. Thank you. Oh, and not take my doodle with me. Right. So this is a bespoke GP surgery. It's a what they call a lift building, so it's privately financed and then rented. So we have a nice little kitchenette here. We have a clinical hand wash basin here. We have a TV here. And so, you know, I go, well how do you use this room? Oh, well, it's for teaching and et cetera. So, well, do you ever have any patients in here? No. So, Why do you need that then? And why was it ever specified in the first place? And it's kind of, you know, they're trying to make these multifunctional rooms, and it's a great idea, but in practice, it's not working. This is never used because they're just making cups of tea. So this now has to go onto the little used outlet flushing register, which is another pain. So somebody's got to go in and clean it or wash it or we put it on the cleaning register so we know it's cleaned every day, but then the cleaners know it's never used, so they don't then bother cleaning it. So it's all of these human interactions. This is a disabled toilet, again in a GP surgery. I have no idea why we need two hand wash basins. Really no idea. I asked them, why did we need this? But and that was signed off and built. And this here, I mean, it's impossible to clean. It's just painted surface. And these are relatively new buildings, certainly built within the last 10 years. So, you know, somebody somewhere needs to be talking to their designers about what's happening. On suitable materials, so again, nothing new here. Flexible hoses were raised, I think, probably 10 years or so ago. Because of the rubber inside them, it harbours. If you get bacteria, it will the bacteria will grow. Personally, if I'm going into a GP surgery, I'm not really fussed about things like that, because the patients don't actually come into contact with those at all. They're very rarely, or maybe they're washing their hands in the toilets, but they're certainly not going in for any length of time. I would be hugely worried about those if they were in an intensive care unit, and especially if the hand wash basin was next to the patient's head. This is a flow straightener from an oncology ward. It was a hand wash basin in the middle of a corridor. The corridor basically had areas for the patients. So you've got the lobby, the patient rooms, and then a random wash basin in the middle of the corridor, which was never used. We cultured that, and guess what? Pseudomonas positive. Thermostatic mixing valves, and again, we've seen pictures of those earlier. Great idea. So they're there to make sure that the water is the right temperature for people to wash their hands, so they're not going, oh, hot, oh, cold, oh, hot. So they're a really great idea, in the right place at the right time. But these are getting much, much better designs now in them, and they're much easier to clean, they're much easier to manage. So industry is learning, and industry is moving on very fast, but I don't think that knowledge is necessarily getting back to the specifiers and the architects. Oh, blimey. It's going a bit slow. It's obviously a bit hungry. Yes, the controls here. So now we're making sure that whatever controls are put into the building, so are they going to rely on temperature to keep the water at the right temperature? Are they going to rely on chemicals? There needs to be a discussion about that. I mean, theoretically, if everything's built beautifully, you don't need chemicals. And certainly in the GP surgery I've gone to, they've got chlorine dioxide units all built in to these really small buildings. They don't need them. But then they can't take them out because it's all part of the contract that they've got them in. So it's terribly complicated, unfortunately. So if you don't build them in the first place, then we don't need to worry about them. If you do need them, maybe you put them in afterwards. It may be that your building's designed, you know, like Elaine's, to work on lower temperatures. Fine, you know, but get that built into the contract and make sure that it's properly managed. And also, just make sure that these, you know, they're going to be easy to clean. With Martin's mentioned the famous ledge at the back, and this one, they've even put a plug on. Great, you know. And I know why they've done it, because they don't want stuff going down the back of the sink, but then stuff grows on the end of the plug, or they leave the plug in and then it overflows. So there's so many unintended consequences, unfortunately. So transmission. So now we've got all these bacteria multiplying, growing in our water. How are they transmitted? Well, inhalation, and I found this for you especially. Because it just said everything, really. So you can get inhalation from the toilet flush, inhalation from the shower, inhalation from the drain, and to cap it all off, this flexible hose will actually fit down the toilet for the cleaners to flush the showers, which, again, has happened. And this is another one for our GP surgery. It's a little foot bath for chiropody. Dead legs, shower heads here, which I was told were never used. Well, that's great, until they do use it, and it's stagnant water, and you've got the patient's head just there. So, ingestion, I will just talk about the dreaded water cooler. Please don't put them in if you can help it. This is scale. If you just have a look at them closely, use the water from your taps if you can. It's much, much better idea. And if not, just put vodka in it. That's all I can say.
I feel like that's the lesson from lip balm.
contact. Again, we've talked about hand hygiene in depth, and you know, again, thank you, Martin. I'm not going to cover that all again, but you know, that's another way. And exposure. So how do we get exposed to all of this this contamination on our water? So things like blocked macerators, these came up on an alert from the government not so long ago from NHS Improvements, that macerators have been installed incorrectly and were backing up and then going into the sewage stacks and into patient showers. New designs on hand wash basins and things are helping, but only if they're installed properly. So we've seen these lovely new hand wash basins, but with the wrong taps. So then we're getting even worse splashing. And again, I think Christine alluded to that. Susceptibility. Well, I think we kind of know. Pretty much anybody coming into the hospital is going to be susceptible. People going into GP surgeries are susceptible to a point, but we don't know how they're going to interact with the water. Probably very little. Dental surgeries, well, yes, you are going to interact with that water quite a lot. So then it can't just be a blanket assessment saying everybody's susceptible. You have to think about how and how they interact. If we look at the cost of this and the cost of healthcare acquired infections, this is recent data that I picked off Jimmy Walk actually the other day. We're talking about a lot of money here, and if we could just perhaps save some of these water-based infections, we've now got £100 million a year to put into our new build and getting those right. Before I summarise, I will just pick up, because I think Christine mentioned about about France and how they're doing things perfectly or better than us. I've visited hospitals in France, I've visited them in Germany. For me, I think I would say Scandinavia have got the best hospitals I've ever seen. They are just fantastic. They're always very calm, they've got huge wide corridors, they've got the right staffing levels, but guess what? They pay masses and masses of tax. So if you want that, you know, we have to pay for it somehow, and I get that. It's not just a question, I think, of beating people up and sending them to jail. I think we need to get more money, and hopefully the government's going to provide some. It's just, let's do the right stuff with it. So anyway, there's lots of sources of materials out there for governance. Governance isn't an issue, it's just using it properly. Water hygiene training, and again, I know Lena's going to come onto this, so really important, the training, everybody's trained, everybody in the whole process. And the right type of training as well. You don't give the same training to infection control that you might do for your cleaner, but they all need the right training that's appropriate. Team approach is important from the outset, and really from the design of any new build, they've got to be part of that, and they need to just beat their way into the designer's doors and just go and make their voices heard. And healthcare associated infections are numerous and they are really costly. So that's kind of me. So.
Thank you, and thank you for making something that can be quite dry actually really quite engaging.
Thank you for giving me that subject just before lunch.
I know, I'm so mean. It's only because I know you can do it well. Have we got any questions for Elise?
I knew you would, Dr. Hill.
Go for it.
Oh
my gosh.
Well, Elise, you mentioned in passing different designs of taps and things.
Yeah.
And you'll be aware that some of them have got removable spouts,
yep,
like Mark with 21 plus. And these can be put in a washer disinfector. In your experience, Elise, and when you've answered it, anybody in the room, please, are you aware of anyone who's actually done that? Remove the spouts and say, because of infection control, we think we can do something useful by taking these spouts off either as a one-off or regularly and shoving them in a washer disinfectant. Has anybody ever done it?
Certainly on the water safety groups I sit on, they definitely do.
Right.
So
I've not come across anybody yet.
Well, you must... Oh, go on there, yes, Jonathan.
On a regular basis, so it's part of the routine. Yeah, because... Most places, I think, aren't doing it. they've got the ability.
Yeah. I think that needs to be part of the water safety plan again, you know, and drive it through that way, Nick. That's the best way to do it.
Also, it has to be said that not everyone has a water washer disinfector these days, now their SSDs are off-site.
Exactly. And what sort of frequency are they actually doing it on that's going to make any effect?
Certainly the ones that I work with, it's really only if we get positives, that's when we put them through. There's no point disinfecting stuff.
So people are doing that.
Yeah. Yeah, but not as... It's not as routine. No. It's just
not routine.
No, it's just as remediation for positives, yeah.